Hi, this is Mark from LongIslandWatch.com, and welcome to another episode of Watch and Learn. Today, maybe part two, probably going to be three parts of sizing your bracelet. Going to tackle pins and collars today. I know that everybody wants to know how, but I had to start baby steps first before we take bigger steps. So we did the friction cotter pin bracelets in the last Watch and Learn. You should watch it if you didn't check it out. If you know everything, great, but I use a couple of tools there, and I'm going to use them again. I'm not going to really explain how they work. Maybe some of them are self-explanatory, but it's a good basis before you watch this one. So we're going to be tackling, like I said, pins and collars, or pins and pipes, as Seiko calls them. And pins and collars really got their start, you know, at least for me, on the Seiko Monster. Yeah, this thing's missing. He's missing some parts. Again, another watch from the junk bin. But I've got a full-up bracelet that I'm going to size. But Seiko has continued the tradition of pins and collars, and they are now on the Seiko Turtles. And we are selling this bracelet now. It's a really nice bracelet. So Seiko's been using pins and collars, and many people, you know, go to size their bracelets, not familiar with it, and they mess it up. If you do not know the collars there, you lose the collar, the bracelet falls apart, end of story, and then you got to try to get collars from, you know, eBay or Seiko USA or something, and you know, eventually you get them, you get your bracelet put back together. But it's very annoying for the customer, because they'll get their bracelet, they get it sized, they walk out of the jewelry store, or they did it themselves, and they get up and they go to the door, and splat, the bracelet falls apart, and maybe they call us and blame us for selling garbage, or maybe they go to the jeweler and yell at them because they don't know what they were doing, which is probably the case. If you are bringing a watch to a jeweler, to a watchmaker, just tell them, hey, it's pins and collars, if you know it's pins and collars. So pins and collars are in Monsters, they're in Turtles. They are in most ceramic bracelet watches because using a cotter pin with only two friction surfaces, not that good for ceramic. So to prevent it from cracking, it's a better interface if you use a pin and a collar. And I'll go over the pin and a collar in a minute, and I'll show you how it works. Because once you know how it works, you know, you can devise your own methods of installing it and removing it. I'll do a wrist check real quick. Still in love with my Yachtmaster Blue. And then another watch I'm wearing is a new one for me. It's a Seiko World Timer Prospec Solar. Love the watch. But I'm wearing it for a specific purpose because I just sized this yesterday and something happened. So I want to go over that in the video. So today we're going to do the pin and collar bracelet sizing, and we're just going to use pretty much a standard spring bar tool and one of these little, you know, pin pusher devices. I also use a punch. You don't have to. You can use this instead if you're on a budget or if you don't have anything lying around. Like I said, some of the stuff I'm going to say you can use paper clips. It's really crazy. Anyway, so let's get over to the table and let's see what I've got lined up for you. So let's get into discussion of pins and collars. So in front of you here in the tweezer, I've got the collar, or the bane of many people. You can see it's rather small. I'm holding a pair of tweezers. This is the little item that slips up so many people when they go to size a watch bracelet. I'll go over what's in the background in a minute, but this makes the difference between doing the job right and doing the job totally wrong, and the watch just falls off your wrist. So let's discuss what's in front of you here. The first thing, obviously, is a Seiko Monster and the associated bracelet. I've got a watch strap tool. Small fork on one end, big fork on the other. I have the pin pusher tool that I used in the last Watch and Learn. Again, you should watch that one before you watch this one, because I'm not going to cover everything. And then lastly, I have, just as a point of reference, this is the new bracelet for the Seiko Turtles that we started selling. It's a beautiful bracelet, but of course, it uses pins and collars. So just because you don't have a Monster doesn't mean you don't need to know how to size a pin and collar bracelet. And then as a little added bonus, of course, I've got the collar. And then the associated pin. Now, Seiko, for some reason, does not call them pins and collars. If you look through their parts lists, they call them pins and pipes. Kind of a weird name, but, you know, I've always referred to it as pins and collars. Seiko, for some reason, maybe it's the translation, but they call it pins and pipes. Before we even get started, and this would go with sizing any bracelet, probably should have been mentioned in the last Watch and Learn, is that whenever you size a bracelet, you should always, always, always look out for random things to happen when the links come out. Look for extra pieces or things you may have missed that is not just the links. So like if you're looking for a collar and the collar falls out, you'll know what it is. You know, the day is saved. if you're not looking for the weird to happen, then you could very well miss it. And case in point, just yesterday I was sizing this new Seiko that got added to my personal collection. It's this beautiful Prospex World Time Solar Watch. And I sized the bracelet, and as I sized it, I heard cling, cling, and I was checking everything out, and I knew immediately what had happened. This is the link. It was a standard friction pin bracelet, but these two gold pieces, they're just held through the pin, and they kind of just lay in the bracelet. But once you remove the pin, the gold links fall out. So I'll pick one up. So here's the link. Here's the gold link. That way when you go to put this back on, you know that this gold link just slides right on here. The watch goes together, lickety-split, pitfall avoided. You don't put it together and go, why is my link missing some gold? So just, again, that's just good practice with anything. If you don't know what you're doing or you're not 100% sure of what to expect, then just expect the unexpected and see what's going on. So before we get into it, I want to just bring the pin and collar up close and show them to you. So I'm going to remove the things from the background, and now I can show you. So here is the pin. You'll see it's a straight pin. It's got a larger head on one end. It's got some grooves on it that, you know, don't really matter too much. You probably can't see them. But it's got a little detent in the head for, you know, pushing in, obviously, with a pusher. And then the collar. So I'm going to pick up the collar and bring it up. And here's the collar. Wait for the camera to focus. You can see it's rather small. The way these go together is inside the link, the pin with the large end on where this is, it stays there, and it goes through the link, and this will insert into the collar. And what I'm going to do is it's going to be tough for me to do it on screen, so I'm going to just push it on, and then I'll come back to you in a second. So once you push it on, you're left with this. You have now a pin with two larger ends, so obviously it won't slide out of the bracelet, and this end on the left, this is a little bit wider than the hole in the bracelet, so when you force the pin into that collar, it spreads the collar out, it presses against the link, and there you have a nice, I guess almost like a hydrostatic pressure. It's a very even pressure condition where it's pushing on the link, on the inside of the link, outwards, the same force everywhere. So it's a more elegant solution than the standard friction pin, which probably only hits with two or three points around its outside. It's a much nicer way to do things. More elegant, makes for a smoother bending bracelet, at least in my opinion. I mean, not that I could do a blind test and tell you which are pins and collars and which aren't, but it's just a more elegant solution. And, you know, sometimes the simplest things are not the best. Obviously, this is a little less than ideal because it does take some know-how, but it is really cool. It's a lot more expensive to manufacture than a standard cotter pin. But a lot of times in watches, it is the little things that count. The devil is in the details. So let's get on to it. So how are we going to do this? Well, I have a Monster bracelet. This is a bracelet off of a Seiko Monster. And I took the plastic off of one half. And what I'll do is I'll just show you. I'll remove a link and I'll put it back in. Obviously, if you need to size it, you need to figure out how many links you want to remove. You can watch the previous watch and learn, so you know that you remove the even number of links from both sides. You have micro adjustment in the clasp. Just watch that video, because I'm not going to cover exactly everything. I'm going to use only one tool to do this. Of course, you could use any tools as I showed in the last video. But you know, once you know how the pin and collar works and you've watched this video, you can use your own tools. Invent a way for yourself to do it. I mean, this is the way I do it. It seems to be the simplest. And the least way to mess stuff up. So like I said, I'm using just the bracelet. The watch isn't attached to it. Obviously, when you do it, the watch will be attached to it. You may just wish to open the bracelet from the micro adjustment clasp. It's just easier for me when I'm doing it on camera, so the watch head isn't flopping around. So the tool for the job is going to be this little pin pusher, again, pin vise, call it what you want. And then when we look at the bracelet, we're going to see there's arrows. And that, again, is going to be the direction that we want to push. Something else I should have mentioned in the last video, all these things I think of afterwards. Hopefully the person, if it's a new watch, you got nothing to worry about. If it's an old watch and someone else has sized it before you, generally there's nothing that prevents you from putting the pins in backwards. So kind of like, doing electrical work in your own house, hopefully the guy before you did it right so that the colors of the wires mean something. But always just be careful. If you start pushing and it's not moving, do a check, look in the holes, make sure maybe the pin's in backwards, and you do have to push it opposite to the arrows. But still, the arrows should tell you the way home. So it's telling me to push that way. So what I'm going to do, same thing I did before, I'm going to open the vise. So the vise is open. I'm going to feel around and get the pin into the hole where the pin pusher pin into the hole where the pin is for the watch. I'm going to push gently. It's going to push it against the right side of the block. Okay. You remember we did this last time, and I'll bring it up close to the camera, and I'm just going to start to turn that knob clockwise. And out of the bottom here, my thumb is peeking. You should see the pin start to come out, and there it comes. Here, oh, wow, you see that? That one flew out. You never know what's going to happen, right? Okay, so now I know this pin is out. I am going to drop the pin out. Don't lose sight of it. I'm going to retract this. Now, this is where so many people get messed up. And you go, okay, you do sizing, you put the pin back in, you push it, and you go, oh, it doesn't feel as tight as it was in the beginning. But that's okay, I'm sure it's fine. And 2 minutes later, kerplunk, the watch is gone. So what happened? Well, if you look at the tool, you'll see all of a sudden, the pin pusher changed a little bit. There's the collar. It's right there. Pin pushers are just the right diameter to fit inside the collar. I actually haven't met a pin pusher that doesn't yet, you know, in one of these tools, or if you're going to use one of these tools, the flip side of this. I haven't met a pin pusher yet that, you know, that doesn't go inside the collar. And there's the collar. So I pulled the collar off the tool. This is what, you know, this is the piece, again, that so many people miss. Maybe they put the tool down and the collar, you know, just rolls away, never to be seen again. So here's the monster pin. It's a little bit different than the turtle pin. Definitely has a longer head in this region. So they're definitely different parts, but still the same technique. So you do this again, you know, rinse and repeat, and you take out as many links as you need. So now you're done. You've taken the links out you want to take out, and you want to put it all back together. So first you're going to flip it up. You're going to look at the arrows again. And this was, the arrows are pointing right now in the direction where the collar was. So you know the collar's got to drop into this side. Push the links together, drop in the collar. And then from the other side, I'm going to put the pin in. Put my finger over it so the collar doesn't fall out. Work the pin in. And now if I push it down, you see the collar pokes out just a little bit. So you want to push that down a little bit. So I'm just going to use my tweezers just to kind of flatten it a bit. And it's kind of locked together, not too much. See, now the pin's coming out a little bit. So it's kind of like a game. You have to press the collar down around the pin while holding the pin in firmly. There's a lot of things you can do now. You can put it back in here and press against the pin, and then you need something else of a larger diameter to press against the collar. If you had a punch, you would just take the punch and put it here, and the punch is actually too big to fit in the collar, so when you push it in, it pushes the pin out. And now there's the pin. Now you can use the other side of your strap changing tool, the pin, and you can just press it into the pin, the bracelet, and you just push it in while pushing on both sides. See, I'm pushing with this side, and I'm pushing with this side, and now I've just put it together. And now it's fully seated. You can see inside, you see concentric circles. You know the pin is full, the pin and collar are fully together. Again, on this side, you can see the pins are all seated below flush. You could put it back in the pin vise, like I said. You can use, if you're really struggling and you don't have punches and you don't have large paper clips, which I think everyone does, you can even use this end of the tool to press against the collar because it is larger than the pin, smaller than the hole in the bracelet. You can use anything. Again, the trick is that when you're pushing on the collar, you have to make sure the diameter is the same or greater than the collar so that you're not actually pushing on the pin. So you push on from this direction on the pin, from this direction on the collar, and the whole thing goes back together. It really is fairly simple. If you're unsure of yourself, obviously don't do it. You know, bring it to a professional. But even at a professional's level, you got to just let them know, even if they think, you know, hey, you know, I definitely know what I'm doing. You should tell them the bracelet uses a pin and collar system. But, you know, here I've done it here for, you know, this tool is $8 or $9. I mean, this tool is, I think, around $10 or $12. And that's really all you need. The punches come in the toolkit that we sell for $30, but you don't need the punches. You can use this instead of a punch. This works just fine. You know, the fork end of the tool. And that's it. That's all you need to know to size your Seiko Monster, your Seiko Turtle, any of your, you know, nice watch bracelets. So how do you know if the bracelet you're about to size is pins and collars? Well, you know, obviously you can look it up online and you can see if there's any information about it. But you can inspect the bracelet before you even take it apart. And you can flip it over and look at the arrows. And the direction you're going to push from more than likely is pins and collars. Now, if it has pins and collars, so you can look in the hole, and I'm going to just shine a flashlight down it. So when you look down the hole, I'm holding an LED flashlight to try to highlight it. But in the middle of the screen, you could see that link. You see a pin, and you see a little concentric ring around it. I'm going to just move it around a little bit so you can kind of see it from different angles. You get the lighting different. The inside is the pin, and the outside is the collar. And the other side of the bracelet, you'll actually just see the pin head. So this side kind of looks normal, just pins. But then when you look to the other side, we saw concentric rings. That was the pin in the collar. So that should help you make up your mind of what kind of bracelet you have. If you don't know, ask the people where you bought the watch. If you asked us, I could tell you in a heartbeat if your bracelet's pins and collars. And if I don't know the answer, I can look at the watch and tell you. This is the Seiko that we sized in the last video. And you can see that both sides here, just show, you can see that's the split on the cotter pin. And then here's the other side of the pin. No pins and collars. It's obvious. So this has been Mark from LongIslandWatch.com with Watch and Learn, showing you how to size the pin and collar bracelet that is so popular on the Seiko Monsters, now on the new Turtles, on most of your ceramic bracelet watches, on a lot of the JDM divers, etc., etc. If you like this video, please like it at this time. If you have not subscribed to our channel, please do so. If you have any questions or comments, please put them down below, and I'll be sure to address them as soon as I can. Thanks for watching. Bye-bye.